I don't know about you, but I've been thinking a lot about football lately. Watched a game last night, and football's on my mind. So the idea of the analogy of knowing the plays, to know how to play the game, and to know the Bible, to know how to live life, really connects with me. We are started last week a series called God is Good, and we're looking at the goodness of God. And today I want to talk to you about the goodness of God revealed to us by the goodness of His Word. What I mean by that is that God demonstrates to us His goodness in lots of ways. And one of the most important ways is by the guidance that He gives to us. And that guidance is good. It provides the best for us in life. We're going to talk about that this morning. But here's what I know before I do that. I know that most things in life are probably 20% in information and 80% inspiration. It's not so much that we need to know what to do, although sometimes we do, but it's we need inspiration to do what we need to do. So I want to kind of follow that this morning. So in the first part here, I just want to give you some information about how your life in 2012 can be dramatically impacted by God's goodness. And if you will pull out the sheet that says how to start reading the Bible and praying daily. If you can just kind of pull that out. If you don't have this, raise your hand. And we have some very nice men who will make sure that you get a copy so that you can follow along with us. Here's what I know. And I know this really deeply and profoundly. So please be encouraged by it. The single most important thing to help you to grow spiritually and to become more the person that you want to become this year, the most important thing to help you to become the person that God wants you to become is going to be the time that you spend with the Lord in your Bible and on your knees. And as a church, for the last year, we have followed this practice of encouraging everybody with this, what we call the SOAP method. And it's a way to get into the Bible every day. If you'll just take 15 minutes a day, it'll change your life. In fact, I would give you a money-back guarantee. If you do this year, it'll change your life. So I have just five simple steps here. Let me just go through them with you. Number one, commit to a daily time and place. Some people are morning people. Raise your hand if you're a morning person. Okay? How many are like me and we're night people? So you can either be morning or night, but commit to a daily time and a place by yourself. Secondly, select a good translation of the Bible. We recommend one of two versions, the New International Version Study Bible, and you can get that at pretty much any bookstore at Amazon.com, or the English Standard Version Study Bible. I commend to you a study Bible, because when you follow this, you're going to read things, you're going to go, what is that talking about? And you can just check the notes at the bottom and say, oh, okay, I understand what he's saying. Thirdly, I'm going to ask you, if you've never done this before, to commit to read one chapter of the New Testament a day for 5 minutes. And you say, one chapter a day. Yep, on the back of this handout is 52 weeks through the New Testament. So this year you can read the whole New Testament if you'll just give 5 minutes Monday through Friday. 5 minutes, that's 260 chapters in the New Testament. And if you break it down with 52 weeks, 5 chapters a week, the math works out. Okay, so you can read the whole New Testament. That way you may need to get caught up, but that won't be any problem to get caught up. You can just read on the weekends for a while. Okay, and then number three, find one verse from each chapter. Here's where the SOAP method comes to play. I'm reading through my chapter, maybe I'm Matthew chapter 1, and I read that Joseph was a righteous man. So as I read through it, that might be the scripture that I highlight. So the scripture is going to be Matthew chapter 1, verse 19, talks about Joseph being a righteous man. My observation on that may be Joseph was a righteous man because he wanted to treat his fiancée right. So that's the SOAP would be S is the scripture, the O is my observation, the A is the application. You know what? I want to be a righteous man too. How many people here want to live a righteous life? Yeah. So when I read that, I'm like, good. That, you know, I want to treat people the way Joseph did. I want to be mindful, even when they sin, I don't want to expose them to shame and embarrassment. And then the P part is to pray. So scripture, observation, application, and prayer. And just pray with a simple outline. We usually recommend the Lord's Prayer. There are 6 parts to it. And if you just use that as an outline, it'll change your life. Now, in case you didn't believe me, I have some people up here this morning who are going to talk to you about this method of studying the Bible. And they're going to tell you why you should believe in me in case you don't. So we all welcome Kurt and Bettina. Come on up into the light.
Well, we have a son now that's actually following the Lord very closely. He's actually in Bible school. But to kind of go back a little bit, we decided to take the church's challenge a couple years ago in 2009. We actually prayed through the whole year about a lot of different things. That our son, as you can see up there, he's now married to a very, very good Christian woman. And we decided to take that challenge. It took us a whole year reading through the Bible. And then in 2010, our son made a retreat. Our son was just a wild hare. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Sex, drugs, alcohol, you name it. He was into all that. And he made a retreat after being drunk the weekend before where he didn't even know where he was. And he was in a fraternity. And the next weekend, he made this retreat. And he told the Lord, he said, God, if you'll just take this away from me, I'll serve you the rest of my days. And Aaron was just, like I said, he was way off the path. He knew the difference. He knew that Jesus was the way, truth, and the life. Now he's living that. I totally believe that we committed to that Bible study and hardly missed a day. If I was on the road traveling or if she was out visiting friends and relatives, sometime that night, one of us called each other and we said, it's time to do our Bible study. Now, we did the New Testament challenge in 1 year. And it wasn't easy. We got to Revelation at the end of the year, and we really bogged down. No question about that. But if we missed a day, Bobby didn't mention this, but you do it Monday through Friday, and then you take off the weekends, right? Well, that's time to catch up if you missed a day. But I'm telling you, if you commit to this, you will see the fruits. And I believe that God is faithful to those that find Him faithful and trust in His presence and in His love. Do you agree with that? Aaron and I actually are doing a tour now. He's gone so far as to want to minister to the masses and multitudes, so we're going out on tour now, a tour called A Song and a Sun Tour, where he's going to preach to the youth of the churches, and that's starting to really launch right now. I actually challenged on my Facebook, I put on there, I challenged my friends and my fans to do this, to go try this soap method. And I had a few responses, but it didn't surprise me, Bobby, that not a whole lot of people replied. Because it's a really hard challenge. But Tina and I have decided to do the whole Bible this year, and we're in Job right now. And pray for us, because that's hard. Give us some patience, Job. We're like in 14 through 16 right now. But it's really going to bless us. We know we have a son that's in motorcycle school down in Florida. And he's really struggling with his faith. He knows what's right. That's the good thing. And I believe in Proverbs 22:6 it says, raise your child up right because they'll return back to their training. Do you believe that? And we're seeing that. So,
thank you. Tina, do you want to add anything? I want you to add something, Bettina.
What do you want me to add?
Whatever you want. I just like it when you talk.
I don't do well in front of people who know me know I love to talk, but not in front of large numbers. And when I talk about my children, I'm incredibly emotional. But I can say that just from my heart, for my son who I prayed for, to God, please take this away from him and show him how to serve you. And that, you know, just struggling through the readings we did and trying to figure out, Lord, what are you trying to teach me? But dedicating that to our children so that they can have a relationship with him, that's what was the most important to me. And as Bobby said, we're living proof. I mean, I've got a son who's going to give a sermon next Sunday. You know, I can't, what can I say? But praise God.
Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. God bless you.
Good job.
So let me talk to you a little bit about God's goodness and God's goodness through the Word and why you want to do something like what Kurt and Bettina have just talked about this year. When we talk about God's Word or God's law, it's often called the law because there's commandments and regulations, and it's actually the word Torah is law. So we're going to look this morning at Psalm 119, and it extols the virtues of God's law, of God's Word, and I want to encourage you with that. But let me just say this as I begin. When you think of the word law, or when you think about commandments or regulations, here, let me just speak for myself first. My natural tendency when I hear that is to think, I don't like that. That sounds restrictive. It sounds like it's going to take away my freedom. It's going to take away my joy. Somebody is telling me what I need to do, and I'm not going to like it. Anybody relate to me when I say that that's my natural tendency? I'm not a rule keeper or a law abider. That's not my nature. Okay? So when we think about God giving us His Word in the Bible, and it being God's law or God's way or God's commandments, we fail to realize that actually what it is it's good. Because God is good, and because He loves you and He loves me, He would only want that which is good for us. He wouldn't want to take away our fun. So the spirit of the biblical idea, and I actually quoted from John Willis here, an Old Testament scholar, he describes it this way. He says, the spirit of the biblical idea is that God, out of His deep love for man, desires to give man guidance so that his life can be as full and complete as possible. God's law, or God's guidance for man, is a natural expression of His love, grace, and mercy. Here's what I really believe now after following Jesus for 33 years. After following Jesus for 33 years, I believe in the depth of my being that the law and His Word are so good for us. It is the absolute best path. Because God loves us, His law and His Word gives direction, strength, and delight to us. And because He is good, it is so good for us to follow it. Now, in the primary instance in Psalm 119, he's talking about the Torah, he's talking about the Old Testament, but the principles apply to the New Testament as well. When you think of the law, in the Old Testament, there were 613 commandments, but they're summarized in 10 commandments. In fact, I have the 10 commandments in your outline there if you want to look at them with me. In fact, let's just say them. I'd like you to think about what does it mean to have guidance? And try to imagine a world where we don't have guidance. I've had an opportunity a couple of times to go to Africa and to be in some of the remote places in Africa. And I can tell you, these are places where they don't have God's law. And people mistreat people. They abuse people. Human beings gravitate to sinful, selfish things in thought, word, and deed. And apart from God's revelation of His goodness, that's where we would go. So let's just read these 10 commandments together. And I just want to ask you to think of a world without these. We ready? Number one, have no other gods. Number two, do not worship idols. Number three, do not take God's name in vain. Number four, keep the Sabbath holy. Number five, honor your father and mother. Number six, do not murder. Number seven, do not commit adultery. Number eight, do not steal. Number nine, do not give false testimony. And number 10, do not covet the possessions of others. So here's what I believe. I believe that the most important inspiration is to see God's goodness in His law and in His Word. And so God inspired the writing of Psalm 119. If you open your Bible, Psalm 119 is likely to be in the middle of the Bible, interestingly enough. It is the longest chapter in the Bible, a lot of verses there. In fact, if you listen to it, as I've done a couple of times this week, just to listen to it is 18 minutes to have the whole thing read to you. It's an acrostic poem, so if you take the Hebrew alphabet and each of the letters of the Hebrew alphabet, it was designed so that it could be memorized using the device of the Hebrew alphabet. And God's desire was that young Israelite men and women would memorize this, and then they would know the benefits of it for their lives. So as we read through it, I just wanted to point out 10 ways that it inspires us to know that God's law is good and it reflects God's goodness. So let me just walk through those with you this morning, just kind of a survey of Psalm 119. The first thing it teaches is that God's word blesses me. That God's word blesses me. Now, I'm not used to that word bless, because other than in religious circles, it's not used very much. But what it means is that God's word makes me happy. That God's word is creates well-being. That knowing what God says, it's good for me. It says this, blessed or well-off or happy are those whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the law of the Lord. Blessed, happy are those who keep his statutes and seek him with all their heart. They do no wrong but follow his ways. So the Bible says, and I testify, Kurt and Bettina just testified, and anyone who has spent time with it can testify that it is a state of well-being, knowing God's word. That God is good, and I'm in a good place, and you're in a good place when we know and follow God's word. I'm happy. It makes me happy. I know the way. I have God's direction, and there's a real sense of well-being and peace in knowing the creator of the universe, who knows what's best for us. He knows what's best for me, and he knows what's best for all of us, and he has revealed to us the path for our best, so we are blessed. Number two, as you read through it, it says, God's word gives me the path of purity. It says it this way in verse 9, how can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. That's why I always say the best habit that you can ever get to is to know God's word and to follow God's word and to experience the blessing of purity. We often don't think of purity as a blessing because often in our culture it's come across as restrictive and inhibiting and repressive. But purity is an absolutely wonderful thing. And I can tell you that the people who have known God's word from their infancy on up and who have followed it have this purity about them that is just so wonderful and beautiful. Many of us have been thinking this week about Tim Tebow, and many of you saw the game last night and maybe the interview beforehand. And the thing that stands out to me, in fact, I have a quote I'm going to read just in a little bit from Michael Medved in the Wall Street Journal. Michael Medved is actually a Jewish guy who's extolling the virtues of Tim Tebow. Is that here's a person who was raised from even before he was born, when the doctors advised his mother to abort him because of birth defects, and she committed him to the Lord and called him Timothy, you know, to a biblical name to give honor, and that he would be a preacher like Timothy. Is that here's a guy who was raised from infancy with the word of God, and there's a purity about him. I don't know if you saw it, but even the Saturday Night Live spoof on Tim Tebow, which was really funny to watch, that what was so funny about it is they know he's genuine and sincere and pure. In fact, he's a real contradistinction to so many people in our culture where we're aware of what the opposite of purity is, and that is how we tend to gravitate to things that are immoral and bad. And even Michael Medved in the Wall Street Journal article said, you know, in a culture where we're used to millionaire football players who beat their wives or who are dog killers or all these other things, to have somebody who's so genuinely pure and innocent. Parents, the best thing that we can do is on a daily basis to bring our children back to God's word, to share God's word in daily devotionals with our kids. And then as they grow older, by the time they're in late middle school or junior high, to enable them to find the purity of God's word by reading what it says so they know for themselves. The best way that you can help your child to really follow God is it's helpful for you to tell them about purity, to stay away from pornography, to help them to stay away from pornography, to help them to stay away from swearing and lying and all these things that start to become predominant in junior high. And then when they go into high school, to not get drunk and to do drugs or to be sexually involved or all those things. But you know, you can tell them those things, but if a child sees that that's what God's word says for themselves, that is far more powerful than just the words of their parents. And I can tell you from the people that I know, from the symbol of, a person like Tim Tebow to, for example, one of our elders, David Sanders, was over at my house a couple of months ago, and we were just talking about, you know, the best testimony in the world is somebody who grows up and they know the Lord from the beginning, and that they've tried to follow God all their lives and they've known that purity. You know, when you go into a marriage as a virgin and you stay faithful to the one wife, or the wife stays faithful to the one man. I mean, that is such a blessing. And to be pure people who avoid those things is just an honor to God, and it's our best path. Number three, God's word keeps me from selfishness. I'll just say it again. My natural tendency and yours is to make the world revolve around me. Like Bobby Harrington was the most important person on planet Earth, which is not true at all. But what is going to restrain your natural impulses and mine? Only the teaching that we were made to honor and glorify God and that we're to live for Him, and He tells us how to live. It says this in verse 35, "Direct me in the path of your commands, for there I find delight. Turn my heart toward your statutes and not toward selfish gain." Number four, God's word shows me God's promises. It gives me hope. I don't just follow it because God says it. I follow it because God says it and because God is good. And in it, He gives me promises. And His promises become the foundation of how to live my life for Him. It says in verse 49, "Remember your word to your servant, for you have given me hope. My comfort in my sufferings is this, your promise preserves my life." Let me tell you the reality. The reality is that in your life and mine, we will suffer. We will go through hardships. It is the nature of life on planet Earth that we will have difficulties. But in the midst of difficulties, here's this, God is with us and He has promises for us. The goodness of God is intended to be ours even in suffering and hardship. We have this passage in the New Testament that says that God works in all things for the good of those who love Him, that our character would be developed. But I will just tell you that God's word promises us this, that we will experience goodness in our life. Next week we're going to look at Psalm 23. It says, "Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life." That is God's promise to you and to me. And that is a wonderful promise. And I need to hear that promise again and again and again. Not just that I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever, but that He's with me. And His rod and His staff, they comfort me. His promise is that He will provide for me food, clothing, and shelter. That He has every hair on my head numbered. Every day of my life is in His hands. That God hears and answers my prayer. And by reading His word, I'm reminded of the goodness that He intends in this life for me and for you. Number five, God's word gives me good judgment. I want to have good judgment. You know, it is easy to live out this life and to come into lots of circumstances and lots of areas and not necessarily know how to handle things in and of myself. But God's word gives me good judgment. Verse 65, "Do good to your servant according to your word, Lord. Teach me knowledge and good judgment, for I trust your commands." I trust your commands, God, and so it's going to give me good judgment. It's going to show me how to live life in the best possible way. He's talking about specific books like Proverbs, which is all about how to live life every day, the kind of rules and the guidelines for good judgment every day. Even things like the Ten Commandments, we just take them for granted. Do you know that modern law in both Europe and the United States is built around the Ten Commandments and the laws of the Bible? And we've been so blessed by them. I can tell you this. I grew up as a Canadian, and I have spent a lot of time now because this is my home looking at America. And I can tell you that America is unique in the good judgment that the nation has had because the commandments of God and the teachings of God have been at the root of the nation. In the 1800s, there was a famous French sociologist, one of the first sociologists, Alex de Tocqueville. He came and he surveyed America, and here's what he said, and it's still true, that America is great because America is good. And America is good because it has been founded on the teaching and the wisdom of God. Now, I believe that that's eroding. I believe we're turning our backs on that, and I believe that's tragic because God's word gives us such good judgment. Even simple things like, take, for example, a work environment. Some of you own businesses. Most of us actually work for others. So think about the wisdom and the good judgment of just following the Bible. If we follow the Bible, we'll know that we're to work hard, that we're actually working for God, not for people. That we should be honest in all things, because ultimately we're going to have to answer to God for everything that we do. That we should listen to older, wiser people who have been there before. That we should treat other people as we would want them to treat us. Can you think of better ethics for a company? Better ways to build a community than actually God's good judgment in the Bible? Number six, God's word gives me hope, Psalm 119 says, my soul faints with longing for your salvation, but I have put my hope in your word. My eyes fail looking for your promise. I say, when will you comfort me, O God? And then he goes on and describes, I find comfort in your teachings. They give me hope. Hope in the Bible is this confident expectation that God will take care of me and provide all that I need. I have hope because I believe what the word says, that God cares for me. If you're in bad health, the Bible says God is still with you. He has your best interests at heart. No matter what you face, the Bible says if you trust in the Lord is with you, and he provides encouragement that nothing will destroy you, that God will ultimately take care of you in this life and in the next. Number seven. God's word literally preserves my life. Verse 92, if your law had not been my delight, I would have perished in my affliction. I will never forget your precepts, for by them you have preserved my life. There's a big city in the United States that was a subject of an intense study years ago. In the middle of the city, there was a school, an elementary school, with a really big playground. But they noticed that the children were not playing in much of the playground. You see, there was no fence. There was just this playground. And the kids would kind of huddle toward the school. They wouldn't fill up the playground. In fact, in the whirlabout thing, what do you call the whirlabout? Merry-go-round. The kids wouldn't go on the merry-go-round. And they tried to figure it out. And finally somebody said, you know, let's put up a fence. So they put up a fence around the playground, and all of a sudden the kids filled the whole playground. They used the merry-go-round, and they played through the whole area. See, they had been afraid that maybe a ball would go in the street, or maybe they'd get too close to the street, and it was dangerous. Likewise, God's word puts a fence around our lives. We can know what's safe to do. Within the teaching of God's word, we can fully enjoy life and be happy and blessed and know what's going on because God, by his teachings, preserves us and protects us. Imagine a world where people lied to each other and committed adultery and coveted and misspoke about one another and violated all of God's commandments. That's a world that's very dangerous for everyone. But on the other hand, in a world where everyone follows God's commandments, when you follow God's commandments and I do, we are preserved, we're protected, and we are blessed because his word is good. Number eight, God's word makes me wise. You say wise, yeah. Verse 97, oh, how I love your law. I meditated on it all day long. Your commands are always with me and make me wiser than my enemies. I have more insight than all my teachers, for I meditate on your statutes. The difference in the Bible, by the way, there's a slight difference between good judgment and wisdom, although they're related to each other. Wisdom is knowing how to live in the practical affairs of life. It's daily prescriptions on how to handle things. For example, let me just share one passage to you that's actually, it's in the New Testament, but it's drawn on the Old Testament, but just show kind of the practical wisdom if everybody followed this statute or this commandment. Here's what it says in Peter. It says, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. For a man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Let me just take that for a second. Think about it. If everybody was really quick to listen, if we were slow to speak, and slow to become angry, what wisdom for life. Or simple things like the book of Proverbs says, he who gathers money little by little makes it grow. There in that one verse, we have this description of what economists call compounding interest, which is the key ultimately to wealth. Another passage that says, it's a foolish person who co-signs for loans for other people, or he who wants to make money quick is foolish. And so the wisdom of God for our lives is found in his word. And lastly, our time's pretty much up. In fact, Frank, if you guys will come up, God's word lights my future. I love this expression. One of our elders actually prayed this morning, and this is what he said. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Think of it, we're in a dark world, and we have this lamp so that my feet know where to go and I can see the path. That's what God intends for you and me, by his word. And then lastly, verse 10, God's word sustains me with God. God's word actually sustains me in my relationship with God. See, the word is not just the word. The word is my connection with the Lord. Luke Van Fletteren, who grew up in this church and is doing an internship with us, he is part of our sermon club, and he emailed me his reflections on Psalm 119. And listen to what he said, because it's so good. This is a 20-year-old man. This is what he said. The psalmist delights in the word of the Lord. It's in some ways the very meaning of his life. But that joy and love comes from the fact that the Lord himself is teaching him, the psalmist. The Lord himself is teaching me. The Lord himself is teaching you. Ultimately, God is what drives this writing. It is God that we encounter and God we delight in as we experience the word of the Lord. He says this in verse 175, let me live that I may praise you. May your law sustain me, for I have strayed like a lost sheep. Seek your servant, for I have not forgotten your commands. So I say to you this morning, God is good, and his word is good. God loves you, and he seeks to guide you, and in his word, you will find the expression of God's love, grace, mercy, forgiveness. God will give you strength, direction, and power for your life if you will devote yourself to studying and being in God's word every day. May God bless you with the teaching of Psalm 119.